Ladies and gentlemen, children of today, we term as juveniles under the age of 18, are a useless, worthless, shiftless blight. They have no respect for adults, the opposite sex, authority, and very little respect for themselves. They're lazy, shiftless, useless. God help this nation if we must depend on the likes of them to protect us against the ever-rising threat of communism. God help us if we must depend on the likes of the kids coming up today, if we must depend on them to run our nation in the future. Now I'm wondering just how these questions, these statements rather, are sitting with you. Just what effect they have on you. If they have the same effect on you that they have on me every time I hear them, then your blood has reached a boiling point and just about now you're ready to flip your lid. But on the other hand, if you're the gentleman or the lady who sits back and agrees with everything I've said, that our kids are useless and worthless, then I feel extremely sorry for you. Extremely sorry.
This man's name is Leroy Helming. His job is children. As a detective with the 11-man juvenile squad of the Baltimore County Police Department, he has handled children, matched wits with them, reasoned with them, threatened them, or thrown the book at them if he thought they deserved it. At the beginning of this particular night's work, Corporal Helming is engaged in a luxury that occurs all too seldom to members of the juvenile squad, the opportunity to aid in the prevention of crime by talking to parents and teachers of the teenagers for whom he is responsible. Usually the work is less academic. Hours of driving, watching, reporting, attempting to do a job which, for geographical reasons, is well nigh impossible.
Juvenile squad at night, the patrol that we put out on the road at night, has to cover 620 square miles. Baltimore County surrounds Baltimore City, with the exception, of course, of the harbor area. And we extend the entire perimeter of Baltimore City up to the Pennsylvania state line, to Anne Arundel County, Harold County, so forth. That's approximately 620 square miles and approximately 195,000 children in this area. We attempt to hit all the hot spots, the drive-ins, teen centers, pool halls, drive-in movies, some of your local nightclubs that cater to the younger class with dance bands and this sort of thing. The object of our patrol is not to prevent the children from having fun, it's to prevent any crime.
Because of the fact that Corporal Helming drives an unmarked car, wears civilian clothes, seems to possess an instinctive knowledge of where trouble is brewing, and often manages to slip into places unnoticed, many teenagers in Baltimore County call him the Gray Ghost or the Lizard. In his own words, the words of his wife, and the words of those with whom he deals, this is the story of Corporal Helming's beat, his philosophy, the long hours of watching and checking that merged to become the Night of the Lizard.
Oh, wonderful.
You've got a good crowd.
Arrests for young people under the age of 18 have increased more than three times as fast as their population growth in the past 6 years. According to police records, juvenile crime is on the rapid rise. In 1962, for instance, children under the age of 18 accounted for 62% of all of the auto thefts in the United States. They accounted for over half of the larcenies, half of the burglaries, almost a third of the robberies. The upward trend in arrests for young people have increased in both property offenses as well as crimes against the person. And arrests of young girls has increased sharply also. What underlies this whole explosive problem? Is something drastic going to be called for if ordinary, law-abiding citizens who pay high taxes, are going to be able to live their lives without having to worry about young hoodlums and thugs endangering their safety?
Sure, I know there's a lot of juvenile crime in Baltimore County, but I also know that kids are not born bad. Somewhere along the line, they've been misguided. They've made a bad step. One fatal mistake. My job as a juvenile officer is to try to prevent them from making that fatal mistake. What concerns me when I see that boy out there like that, the fact that maybe one of these nights when I'm working night work out there on the highway, is he going to be the 16-year-old that I pick up for having alcohol in his possession, or is he going to be the 17-year-old that I drag out of a torn-up automobile? These are the things that run through your mind when you watch him. So far, he's managed to pick his company very wisely, his friends very wisely. I'm very proud of him with this. Everybody he's ever brought here to the house are the type of kid that I would have picked for him myself. His girlfriends, his boyfriends, the organization he belongs to. It's the sort of thing that I would want to belong to, and I would want him to belong to. He's always picked his friends very smartly. Well, my child or my children both can get into trouble as easy as anybody else's child. People have the idea, for some reason, that because you're on the juvenile squad that you're an expert with children, and believe me, this isn't so. We're specialists in our field, specialists at handling a delinquent child, but experts with raising them? Quite often friends will call and ask for advice. My child's doing this or my child's doing that. What do you do with your child? What works with my child might not work with their child. There are no two children alike.
I think this is the greatest need today, is with the children. I mean that sincerely. I think we're always going to have crime in other fields, but when you see it growing as it is with the juveniles, I think that's frightening. That's where the most work should be done. Recently, I think the papers, have been full of beatings and policemen being shot. Well, naturally, every time you read that, you sort of panic, but I try not to. I think the gangs are my biggest worry. I think individually, most of the children are just mixed up or little off on the wrong track, but the gang fights I worry about. Of course, the night shift, I think, is the shift that you worry the most on, and it's the most uncertain because everybody knows, naturally, there seems to be more things go on at night. When he's on the night shift, I always sort of dread Friday and Saturday night. I think that seems to be the night when things bust loose for some reason.
About 2 hours out of every day that we work is spent in paperwork, which is roughly about a day out of every week. It's essential, it's something that has to be done. But while we're doing paperwork, we're taken away from our primary function, which is prevention. Of course, the chief has realized this. We no longer have to type all our own reports. We can do them in longhand and we turn them over to a secretarial pool to type them up for us. This gives us a lot of free time to get back out on the road. Paperwork is essential. We must keep a record of every child that we come in contact with, what the child was involved in, its father and mother's name, the date of birth of the child, who handled it, and what the final disposition of the thing was. Quite often people ask me why it's necessary for a police officer who deals with children constantly, day in and day out, to carry a weapon. I think the suitcase is monument and evidence enough why we must carry this sort of a weapon. For instance, this .22 caliber pellet pistol. I took this away from a youngster whose parents were advised by the court that under no circumstances should this boy be given a weapon, and yet they purchased him a weapon like this. Dog chains taken away from two young boys in a junior high school.
using them to extort money from friends. Two revolvers. These were taken away from youngsters in a junior high school. Meant no harm with them, but they sure upset a lot of people in school. Automatics. This automatic was a weapon that was manufactured in Germany and altered in this country so that it would fire shot. Actually, they're blank guns. That lock and chain. This was a weapon carried by a 14-year-old car thief. He felt very insecure without this. Take that switchblade knife, for example. I took that away from a boy in a parking lot of a local drive-in. Very much under the influence of alcohol. The bomb. Bomb was made innocently enough by an amateur rocketeer. But through a twist of fate could cost the life of a small infant and an elderly man. And a zip gun, manufactured by some kid who felt he was a big shot because he carried a weapon. Lord knows why it didn't blow up in his face. Just last week, I took that hunting or fishing knife away from a 14-year-old youngster in a junior high school. It had a 4.5-inch blade on it. As long as weapons like these are in the hands of children on the street, I think it's necessary for every police officer to carry a weapon like the one I carry on my hip. Some of the places I check while on my tour of duty at night seem a little foolish to the layman as to why we check them. They feel that we should be concerned with your major crimes, armed robbery, assault, murder, rape. But it isn't always the major crime that brings the youngster into our hands on his first chance of making a mistake. Besides being illegal for a child to shoot pool or use a pinball machine under the age of 18, it's always that chance that the child will get in, start to play pool, and be talked into playing for a side bet, a wager on the side, losing, and can't pay it. The only way he can pay up his debts is to go out and steal. Then he's taken his first step. He's made that one big break. And from there on in, it may lead him to more dangerous and bigger types of crime. This is why we check your pool halls and your hangouts where pinball machines are played. Your local drive-in where the youngsters gather in the late evening to get their ice cream and soda and so forth. This can be the place that they make their first step. It's not usually, but it can be. Any place where youngsters will gather in large groups, riding round and round in their automobiles, spinning wheels, and car hopping, running from car to car. The first step may be taken with a fight between two boys, a rivalry over some young lady, or even an argument between two fraternities. Usually, you'll find a youngster coming on a lot like this with a six-pack of beer in his car, trying to be a big shot, showing off for the rest of the boys. This is that first big step. The shopping centers around Baltimore County have a very large parking lot. And even though the shops are closed and the lights are all turned out, this is an excellent place for youngsters to gather in large groups. I've on occasion had to try to disperse groups of 150, 200 youngsters playing football on these lots, running across the hoods of cars, across the roofs of cars. Anytime when you check these lots, you can expect to find between 50, 60, 70 kids collected, boasting about their engines on their cars, trying to goad one another into, as they call it, spinning wheels on these lots, drag racing. It is always a chance that one of these youngsters will lose control of that car, blow a wheel, or some innocent bystander is injured. We as police officers have no control over these lots. They're private lots. We have no authority to keep the kids moving off of these lots. To my knowledge, there's no law in Baltimore County against assembling on these lots for youngsters. often I'm asked by various people what I feel about the teen centers. And I frankly, I think that there's too wide of an age span for most of the teen centers around Baltimore County. I don't feel that a 13-year-old girl is any match for a 19-year-old boy. I don't think they should be at the same dance at the same time. I think they should be set up for 13 to 16 and 16 to 19 on different nights. Teen centers, for most part, have a very healthy atmosphere. The youngsters seem to enjoy themselves, have a great time. But it disturbs me a little bit as to why, for a dance for children, is it necessary to keep two auxiliary police officers on duty at all times? Teen center, the youngster graduates to a place like this. Basically, it's an adult nightclub where beer is served, or any alcoholic beverage. We constantly check these places for the fear that a youngster will slip through and take his first big step right here in violating the law, develop a taste for alcohol, and which will lead him on to more serious crimes. We realize that it's a job for the owners of places like this to keep a constant watch on everybody that comes in, especially when they carry crowds as large as this place does. For this reason, we're constantly checking with the owners to see what sort of a system they're using to make sure that there are no teenagers sliding through or minors sliding through and purchasing alcoholic beverages. If we find a system that's good, we quite often recommend it to other owners of these concerns. That first step could be taken right in a place like this, a remote, out-of-the-way section of woods on the Loch Raven watershed. The youngsters park their cars up on the road, come down along the edge of the water, spread their blankets, and open up their beer and just have parties. We had ordinances passed prohibiting the use of the parking areas after 10 p.m. There is no alcohol permitted in these areas, but the only way we can control this is through routine patrol.
Let me see your driver's license registration. Police department.
Right.
Young lady, let me see some identification on you, please. How about you in the bank? You have any identification on you? Okay, let's all hop out. Come on, hop out. You with a can of beer over there.
What can of beer?
Can in your hand over there. Come on, let's slide out this side. Come on, out. All right, let's have some identification on you real quick. How old are you?
17.
17? Where'd you get the beer?
Fellow bought it for us.
Fellow bought it for you. Whereabouts did you buy the beer, son?
Place called Ray's.
Look, let's all... You, go back and get in that police car sitting back there, son. The rest of you.
I gotta get home.
You'll get home when I let you go home, son. We're going back to the station house. Talk this thing over. Get
it's
your
1
parents.
O'clock.
I don't care if it's 2 o'clock in the morning. It don't make any difference to me, son. Come on, let's go. You follow me back to the station.
Okay.
I'll keep your driver's license and registration.
For the sake of a few beers, here's a couple of youngsters have taken that first step. I wonder if they really think it was worth it. I wonder if their parents will think it was worth it.
The police department. This is Detective Corporal Helming, Juvenile Squad, Baltimore County. I have your son in custody at the Towson Police Station headquarters. I picked him up along with 4 of his compadres in an automobile and operating in possession of alcoholic beverages. Seems that they went out and bought themselves a case of beer tonight and proceeded to have a party. Well, ma'am, he's right here, and he paid $1.75 for it. Whether he had money or not when he left the house, he had money when he bought the beer. Now, I will release him in your custody if and when you come to the headquarters building tonight. Pardon? That I couldn't tell you, ma'am. In Towson, police headquarters in Towson.
I never enjoy informing parents that I have picked their child up for some violation of the law. I always put myself in their shoes, how I would feel if somebody called me in the middle of the night, told me this. What makes it especially tough, I think, is the fact that when you tell a parent that you've picked their child up for drinking or fighting or whatever it may be, in effect what you've told them is they've failed in some small measure in raising the child, or it wouldn't be in the hands of the police right now. And it's never a very welcoming thing to be told that you failed in the biggest venture of your life, that of raising children. At the end of a night's turn, I quite often wonder myself whether this 8 or 9 or 10 hours that I've put in have really accomplished anything. The youngsters that I've picked up, have I just given them an unhappy experience to remember? Or has some of it rubbed off on them?
Well, my first encounter with Corporal Helming came as a result of being out with a group of boys one night, and we're looking for something to do, and eventually we ended up just stupid wild stuff and breaking streetlights and that sort of thing. And eventually, naturally, we were picked up and taken to the station. And we were turned over to our parents, and then later, Corporal Helming came to school to talk to me. And I was scared. I'd heard a lot about him, the gray ghost and all that sort of thing. And I was pretty worried. And, well, Corporal Helming talked to me, and he started out, and he seemed sort of tough. But then after he finished talking to me, what eventually boiled down was to, he said, if I would play it straight with him, he'd play it straight with me, and we keep it strictly on the level. And I appreciated this, and I was impressed and grateful that a police officer, was concerned enough to talk to me in this manner and really care what I had to say. And as a result, he talked after the talk I had with him, it helped me out a lot, and since then I've been out of trouble, and he's really helped me by the way he handled this case.
This is a Channel 2 editorial. If it is true, and who can doubt it, that one of the major assets of our nation is its young people, then it seems equally obvious that one of our major concerns should be their care and protection. Laws protecting our property are many and have been developed from antiquity. They are enforced by a legion of police around the clock. Laws protecting our youth are comparatively recent, leave something to be desired, and are enforced in most areas by limited personnel in overworked juvenile squads. At night in Baltimore County, for example, one man has the patrol duty in a vast area that runs from Dundalk to the Pennsylvania line, where, as he points out, there are 100 ways and places for impulsive youth to take the first wrong step. We're now emerging, let us hope, from a generation in which it was fashionable for parents to spare the rod, to allow children to follow their natural tendencies. This was an easy way for the parent to avoid the punishments that might have impaired his popularity with his offspring. All too often, it has been shown that this fashion is a ghastly mistake, the results of which too frequently appear in the records of juvenile crime. Across the nation, however, there are reports of a backlash of public opinion about offending minors. A Montana judge of juvenile court has been widely hailed for his new policy of giving full publicity to underage offenders and their parents, plus stiff sentences where the crime calls for it. 27 states have, in recent years, passed laws making parents responsible for vandalism by minor dependents. And a similar change in Maryland laws, first proposed here on Channel 2, was sidetracked this year by Maryland legislature preoccupied with such matters as tax increases and equal accommodations. WMAR-TV believes that if we want to give a reverse turn to the upcurve of malfactions among the young, we must assume the burden of being the hard guy who hands out unhappy punishment to the willfully disobedient and who keeps firm but understanding restraints on juvenile behavior. Among the better weapons in this fight is the dedicated, compassionate police officer who, like his fellows on all our police juvenile squads, works so patiently and effectively with our young people that they give him the respectful nicknames of the Gray Ghost and the Lizard. About him we say, as the poet said of Abou Ben Adam, may his tribe increase. This has been a Channel 2 editorial, Bob Cochrane speaking for WMAR-TV.
Certain relatively small parts of the world doesn't seem to me, at any rate, such a terrible sacrifice.
Mr. Preston, any questions for Mr. Butler?
Mr. Butler, I know you're in a hurry, but there are a few things I'd like to get on the record now before you go.
Please.
Mr. Butler, you've told us about this, I think you called him the well-intentioned but luckless traveler. And I get the picture of a kind of Laurel and Hardy character fumbling his way through foreign countries. Now, can you tell us, perhaps a little more precisely, just what it is the State Department fears from this fellow? What might he do that would put the United States in jeopardy?
Well, the most obvious thing he might do, I suppose, is to get himself arrested. Then if the United States happened to be in delicate negotiation with the arresting government, a United States citizen in their hands will give them a bargaining counter.
Only if we acknowledge an obligation to the person who'd been arrested.
Well, of course. And we do.
Why?
Why?
I don't quite see what you're getting at, Mr. Preston. Obviously, the government has a duty to protect United States citizens.
That's what I'm getting at. Where does that duty derive from? Can you show me the provision in the Constitution that charges the government with responsibility for the welfare and safety of its nationals when they're abroad?
Well, perhaps not in the Constitution, but there is a statute.
Well, we maintain that the right to travel is a constitutional right, and any law contrary to that, we maintain, is unconstitutional. I'm not at all ready to let the government arrogate powers and duties to itself, no matter how much it may claim to be acting in my interest.
Mr. Preston, the intent of Congress is that every citizen is entitled to the protection of his government. You're not questioning the constitutionality of that.
I certainly am. I'm unable to find any constitutional basis for this big brother attitude the government has assumed toward Americans who happen to be out of the country. And if you once dismiss that attitude as unnecessary and even improper, I think you can see that Mr. Butler's reasons for keeping Americans out of a place lose their force.
Well, let me read something to you. This is from the majority opinion in the case of Dennis versus the United States.
I'm familiar.